Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. What we're doing right now is what we call a radical experiment. That's right. It's Friday, August 7th. We're doing a day and date show. We're doing the news with Teresa Strasser. You guys, tell us how you like this. I know what we've been doing in the past is we've been taping the shows and running them the following week or later that same week or what have you. But we wanted to do a show that was day and date, more like a regular morning show. And I just want to know what you guys think. So, you know, hop on the message board, give us your feedback. But I thought, well, let's start with Teresa and let's do today's news. T?
Well, there's two big judge stories in the news today, Adam. And I don't know which is more culturally relevant. I'll have to get your opinion. Sonia Sotomayor won confirmation yesterday as the nation's first Hispanic Supreme Court justice.
She's from America's Got Talent.
That's the other judge story. That is Paula Abdul from American Idol. It looks like she will not be returning.
Well, now, I was watching this story, and I was thinking, what is up? First off, I'm sure she's loaded. When I say loaded I mean high as a kite. No, I mean, she doesn't have a discernible talent or skill. Do you know what I mean? Like, when you're Tom Brady and you say, I need to be traded, or you're Peyton Manning, or I need to be traded, or Kobe Bryant, I want to be traded, everyone goes, great, he'll go to Milwaukee and get $1 million extra, maybe $10 million extra, yep, maybe $100 million extra. You know, when you're David Beckham, you go, I want to be traded from Manchester United to go to some crappy team in East LA, but I'm going to, I have a talent. I have a talent.
It's quantifiable.
Paula Abdul is going to go from this to selling her own essence on QVC. Do you know what I mean? Like, what is her gig? And as I always complain about these things, you know, when you hear about these stories like, oh, hey, Ryan Seacrest going to get $15 million a year. Not a year for 4 months.
Right.
Not a year. Yeah. You have to do that. You have to do the school teacher math where it's like, hey, these poor people have to live on $61,000 a year. No. They don't work. If you count Christmas and you count Easter and you count the summer and all that, they probably work 182 and a half days out of the year and are
what
off the other.
What about the months they phone in emotionally?
Yeah. So just
to include that if it's LAUSD.
Have a TA do the work for them. The point is you have to do this sort of math. And Paula Abdul is looking at, I don't know, eight figures. And it's not eight figures a year. I mean, like we all, if anyone said to us, hey, you're going to do a morning radio show, Teresa Strasser, you're going to do a morning radio show, you're going to get $15 million a year, you'd go, wow, that's pretty good. But at least the alarm would go off every day at 4 a.m.
Yeah, I might get 4 weeks off.
Right. Paula Abdul and the rest of these billionaires, they're not working now. They weren't working a month ago. I mean, they work 4 months out of the goddamn year. And then what's that work week really like? Especially once they get back to L.A. for Paula Abdul.
Right. Well, okay. Here's what I think she brings. She brings a Vicodin patchy sense of slurry danger.
Right.
You don't know what's going to happen. You don't know if she's going to be high that day or sober. You don't know if she's going to...
She's an international retard of mystery.
Remember when she thought she had seen a performance and she started critiquing it?
Right.
But she'd seen it in a rehearsal.
Right.
And her fillings were talking to her and no one knew what was going on.
Also, I'm going to miss the jingling of all her bracelets and earrings and clamp-on stuff as she's like prattling on.
Well, she might end up on So You Think You Can Dance. Do you watch that?
I've seen the commercials.
They have guest judges that sit in. So she may end up doing, which would actually make sense because she was a dancer choreographer.
Okay, but what is the story? The several million dollars
Here's
a year for doing next to nothing is not good enough for her, or she doesn't like the new chick, or what's up?
Here's what the Hollywood Reporter is saying. Paula Abdul asked for a $20 million deal. They offered her a $10 million multi-year. And what is being reported is that she's being offered 30% raise, which isn't bad. Most of us get a 5% raise every year. So 30% isn't bad. Now, there's also the theory that this is all just a ploy. She's going to come back. TMZ is reporting that insiders say she's coming back to the show. This is all about money and buzz. Because American Idol is amazing at generating buzz.
Yeah, and there's something every year that does it.
Yeah, there's always something. And meanwhile, they're going to have some guest judges because they're already starting to audition people. So I think they're going to have Victoria Beckham, Katy Perry, those...
Victoria Beckham. What's she going to do? Give lessons on vomiting and getting mystic tanned?
And lip syncing.
And fake boobs and lip... Oh, God. She is, by the way, you know my female impersonator thing?
She's one of them.
She's turning into like a tan stick with fake boobs. She really has a body dysmorphic issue.
I think
something's
so.
Something's wrong with her.
Speaking of, can I say, have you been watching Entourage this season?
Yes.
Okay, I rented the HBO documentary Thin about eating disorders. Mm-hmm. And then I watched the TiVo'd episode of Entourage, and there were more anorexics on the ladder.
Yeah, even Eve looks anorexic.
Eve's girlfriend.
She's 122 pounds. Well, to be fair, E is 5'6" 123 pounds. So if he has a girlfriend... That girlfriend has to be 5'1" and 41 pounds. Jeez. Otherwise, she'll dwarf him.
She has that floating head.
You can't
anorexia.
Be with like Rebecca Romijn or something
no,
like
it's
that.
True.
She would crush him in the sack.
It's true. Ari's wife, and then Jamie Gertz is really thin, and then E's ex-girlfriend is overly thin.
Everyone is insanely thin on that show. And yes, the new chick seems like a head that is just floating on a number two pencil.
She has the Victoria Beckham lollipop.
Yeah.
The pencil thing.
Yeah, but Victoria Beckham has the fake boobs and the super skinny thing, and it's annoying to me.
Well, I know that you keep up with your former American Idols on Twitter.
Sure, do.
And,
I do.
Yeah, I do.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you were bummed out yesterday when Twitter was down for a couple hours.
Poof! I didn't know what to do because I was like, what if this is more than a couple of hours? You know, I just like kept screaming at my wife. What if this lasts a day?
How will you get your
social tweets?
Right. How will you get your social networking in? Because Facebook was having trouble too.
I don't get it. Do we like talking to each other or don't we? It's like we're dying to talk to each other, but we don't want to be in the same room. What's going on?
I don't know. I find Twitter just another medium for me to be socially awkward.
Right.
I get nervous. I feel like my tweets have the wrong tone. You know who's a good Twitterer? Lynette Carolla.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
She told me Jay Moore sent her a tweet.
What'd he say?
He said, sorry about your husband's shitty pilot not making it on the air, but I'll be enjoying a second successful season of Gary Unmarried.
That's more than 140 characters.
Well, that he probably just said, hi, how's it going? But that's what I heard.
Gary Unmarried continues.
It continues.
That is a slap in your face.
Oh, the slap in the face is I was offered a guest starring role.
As what? One of Jay Moore's buddies?
Just like a rich guy who's dating his wife. Yeah.
Okay. Well, your wives are good because she does slice of life and she just has an easy breezy tone the way she is in life.
Mm-hmm.
She has good social skills and thus that's manifest in her Twitters.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, Paula Abdul, when she announced she wasn't going back to Idol, she announced it via Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
This is the new thing. And some of the former Idols...
I'm laughing. The reason I'm laughing about my wife's because I was talking to Kevin Hench, the guy I wrote The Hammer with, the guy who does the sports column and I collaborate with, and we were just complaining about our wives as we normally do, what's happened to the female in this country. And what we were laughing about is, you know, Lynette has boundless energy when it comes to anything Bruce Springsteen, but... Not so much when it comes to the sewing and the cooking part.
She just tweeted about
Ace
the
Man.
Springsteen. Yeah.
Right. So I was laughing and I was like, you know what would be awesome? You know what would really motivate her is if Bruce, like, it would be the greatest ploy in the world. I get hold of Bruce and I'm just like, hey, Bruce, here's $50,000. Before you do Born to Run, I need you to do just a little preamble. And he's like, you know, I wrote this next song. Back in 77, I had a girlfriend. Couldn't fucking sew. Bitch couldn't sew. I hated her. I hated her like a Jew hates an Arab. She couldn't sew, and she didn't water the pots either. And I packed up my guitar, and I headed on down to the edge of town and wrote a little song. Called Born to Run because I don't want to be around a woman who didn't know how to wear a singer. 1, 2, 3, 4. You know what I'm saying? Wouldn't that be the greatest diabolical thing ever? And I'd say, Bruce, do it early in the set when she's sober and just have her sit there and really just and don't look at her or anything. I don't want to make it obvious, but just be real serious. Like, water in the pots? That's huge to the boss, man.
Watering the pots is so so specific, though. I think you'd have to keep it more general.
Okay,
to
maybe
you know,
just
gardening.
You know, when I grew up, my mama was in the kitchen.
And
she rattled those pots and pans, and you know what? She was proud of it.
If she hadn't made me a home-cooked meal, I wouldn't be writing these songs.
This next one's called Born in the USA. And that's right where my mom did her cooking.
What's more
no
American?
Shame in it, ladies.
What's more American than apple pie? Homemade. Mm-hmm.
That's right. A la mode. 2, 3, 4. I just thought it'd be, if I was like Bill Gates rich.
How much to buy off Bruce Springsteen?
Well, I would sit down with the boss and I would say, like, look, first off, if you believe women shouldn't know how to sew, definitely speak up. I'll pack up my attaché case filled with 20s and leave right now. But if you know, I don't want to put words in your mouth. Do it your own way, you know what I mean? But just do a little preamble before each song that where my wife's at the concert, you know
what
I mean?
Is she that open to suggestion from Bruce?
I believe if Bruce said he had a song, it made him sick. You know, he had a girlfriend, made him sick that she didn't know how to sew. Because those are things, you know, the, by the way, you know, what if Betsy Ross didn't know how to sew? And we'd be looking at Old Glory on a cocktail napkin right now. My mama sewed her own wedding dress, and I'm proud of that. You know what I mean? 2, 3, 4. And he just, a little tear running down her eye. Her driving home from the concert telling her friends, you know what, we got to stop at the Singer place.
I got to get a Singer. I'm born to run a Singer.
I got to get in there. I got to get a bobbin.
Back to the glory days when women sewed.
I'm just saying,
those were the glory days.
If you were really rich, that would just be, that'd be an awesome way to go.
That's all you're right. You'd have to be Bill Gates rich. Mm-hmm. Or you know what, because I don't think Bruce, he's too rich to be susceptible to a money bribe. I think you'd have to say, Bruce, I'm going to give, if I'm Bill Gates, mm-hmm. I'm going to give $10 million to your charity.
Mm-hmm.
If just at this one concert.
Yeah, just before darkness at the edge of town, you just talk about sewing for like, you know, 10 minutes.
Just do a little patter between songs.
Just a little patter, like you and Max.
Right. It's going to be totally natural.
It's totally organic.
Work it in.
Okay.
Okay, so back to some former idols tweeting.
Mm-hmm.
Danny Gokey
mm-hmm.
got on a social messaging site
mm-hmm.
and said, I'm really sad to, see Paula Abdul not coming back to Idol. She was the judge with the biggest heart. She really will be missed. The whole thing has many people feeling emoticon sad face.
Nobody's going to miss her. Again, there's that sort of, oh, man, what, you know, the train wreck factor. But no. No. But you know what? I'll tell you who's in real danger here. Simon, because when they eventually weed out these people that are essentially bookends, I mean, Paula Abdul is, I don't know what her IQ is, but it's less than, let's say, a gourd that would be in a centerpiece on Thanksgiving. And then Randy Jackson, who's one of the dumber guys on the planet, take those two guys, you get rid of those two guys, and now you're left with Simon, and you put two smart people next to him, all of a sudden he's not Simon Cowell anymore.
He's just kind of a regular guy.
He's in-between guy, yeah.
Although I did just picture one gourd with a lot of jewelry on it and one gourd with some blue eyeglass frames.
Call the other gourd's dog?
Yeah, there's the, exactly. Right. It was kind of a nice picture.
Right.
Like I said, this could just be a ploy. She could be coming back, so... Yeah, more will
we'll
be determined.
Keep our fingers crossed.
Now, does this sound familiar to you? Saturday, March 24th, 1984, Shermer High School, Shermer, Illinois, 60062. Dear Mr. Vernon, we accept the fact that we had to sacrifice a whole Saturday in detention for whatever it was we did wrong. And what we did was wrong, but we think you're crazy to make us write an essay telling you who we think we are. What do you care? You see us as you want to see us.
Well, I actually saw the follow-up. That's the Breakfast Club.
Yeah.
I saw the follow-up, saw the Brunch Club, which was not nearly as strong a couple of years ago. Yeah, the great John Hughes died. When I first heard that, I was like, hey, you know, the director, John, and I was like, please say Waters. Please
don't
say Waters.
Hughes.
Please don't say Hughes. Say Waters. Say that horrible, campy, gay hack Waters is gone, and No, it's John Hughes.
John Hughes, dead at 59. Yesterday, he was just taking a walk in New York City. He had a heart attack, according to a spokesman, and he passed away A lot of people really grew up with those movies.
Yeah.
16 Candles, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, Home Alone, Weird Science.
I forgot how good Planes, Trains, and Automobiles was and how much you hated Weird Science.
I did not get Weird Science.
I love Weird Science because of the older brother, Chet.
Which, awesome. By the way, I read an interview today with Bill Paxton, who played Chet.
You're stewed, but what?
He says that of all the movies he's done, that's the one everyone wants to talk to him about, Weird Science.
Funny, real funny job by Bill Paxton in that movie, who went on to just, you know, do some real serious stuff, but it was really funny in that movie. Well, we were friends with Molly Ringwald growing up, so we were kind of right in that scene. Of course, me and the Wheeze went to the premiere of Pretty in Pink, of course. That's where I got loaded, and he went home with a heifer, and I had to drive home in the rain.
But, he hates this story.
I know. I won't tell the story. But, you know, Molly Ringwald had the hots for Donnie.
And by the way, those two are still in touch.
Molly and Donnie. Yeah.
Yeah.
She had it bad from a man.
Well, Donnie's cute.
He is.
And he's very sweet.
And he was even cuter back then, and she was into him.
Well, now she has a couple of twins just like you do.
Mm-hmm.
So your lives are intersecting again.
So, John, now, the thing, this kind of sad part about John Hughes. And I guess he was just set for life. I mean, did he continue to make stuff?
Because yeah, he made some really, unfortunately, later in life, he made some bad, Flipper and Beethoven, maybe.
Oh, he was doing stuff like that. And then also, he did Drill Bit Taylor.
Yeah.
He wrote Drill Bit Taylor, but he wrote that 10 years or 20 years ago, and then they finally made it, which didn't turn out so good. But although, when my movie got reviewed on At the Movies, they said, surprisingly, a movie that's better than Drill Bit Taylor. And I was like, I know it sounds like a compliment, but really?
It's actually
I didn't think that movie was going to be that
pretty
good.
Pretty insulting. Didn't he try to kill himself, Owen Wilson, just before it came out?
I'd say when the lead tries to kill himself after a movie comes out, it's not like he wants someone to collect his Academy Award posthumously.
There's a few signs. You know, like last night they had the G.I. Joe premiere, and they didn't really screen the movie for critics. That means
not screening a movie for critics and attempting suicide before a movie comes out usually means
Harbingers.
Not your best work.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
So, and also John Hughes, while doing some pretty good work, definitely one of those right place, right timers. I mean, like those bands, you know, that were just there capturing
sort
the 80s.
Nirvana capturing the zeitgeist of the grunge movement.
Yes. Although, yeah, I mean, that's a good example, except for Nirvana was really good, but also just captured that moment. And then there was a lot of bands that just captured, like, the disco moment, like, you know, Donna Summer. And I don't know if, like, Donna Summer was even that good, but she was there, like, right place, right time, you know? And he was sort of in between that and, you know, like he was good, but also real right place, right time. So, Donnie, what are his, he did Mr. Mom, Uncle Buck, She's Having a Baby. Wasn't that a Molly Ringwald thing, too? Or was
I was
that,
trying to remember.
Oh, no, that was another
Elizabeth,
one.
Yeah,
McGovern, yeah.
Yeah, that was a cute
16
movie.
16 Candles. Curly Sue.
Some Kind of Wonderful. And, of course, Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And I was reading an obituary from the AP, actually written by a friend of mine, Chrissy Lemire, who's a great writer. And she closed the obituary with this quote from Ferris Bueller, who said, life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
Yeah.
That was apropos.
Wait, she said that or he said that?
Ferris Bueller said it.
Oh.
Yeah. It's a good way to close the obit.
All right. Well, man, he did a lot of work.
Yeah, he really did. And, I mean, I don't know if this is just people my age, but Breakfast Club kind of allowed you to align yourself with one of these archetypes.
Yeah.
You had to ask yourself, like, were you an Ali Sheedy or Molly Ringwald?
Mm-hmm.
Or were you
I was a prom queen, but I knew that before Breakfast Club.
You didn't need Breakfast Club to tell you that.
I have a little Breakfast Club story.
Oh, okay.
Okay, Molly showed me the script to The Breakfast Club before it was in production. She said, this is my next movie. It's called The Breakfast Club. So she shows me the script, and I'm kind of glancing through it, and I'm like, so what, you're all in the same place? You never leave this detention center? And she's like, yeah, what do you think? And I'm like, I don't think this thing will work at all.
That made her hotter for you, Weezer.
But you guys never,
of course,
like,
I'm wrong again.
Weezer, you guys never kissed or made out or anything. You were just friends.
No, we were just good friends.
But she wanted him. She loved Donnie. And, but she couldn't have him.
He was that just made her want him all the more.
She wasn't heavy set enough.
Oh, come on. Listen, one girl. Like, you had one girl, too.
All right.
Chased you from out of town.
All right.
Well, now Molly Ringwald has twins. The 41-year-old actress told People magazine, "It is exhausting, but it's wonderful. She's got a boy and a girl, Roman Stylianos and Adele Georgiana."
Yeah, Adele's her mom's name.
It's a nice name.
Goddamn, could her mom cook?
Not as well as your mom. Are you kidding?
That's good stuff.
Because your mom would listen to those Springsteen songs about cooking.
Oh, she had the ribbons from the Pillsbury Bake Off proudly displayed in the entry hall of the Corolla home. No, they lived in a house that was, stop me if I'm lying here, Donnie, the house the Ringwalds lived in was 900 square feet, maybe 850. Like, it was a really teeny little valley, little ranch house. It was kept up, and there was nothing wrong with it, a little cluttered. But now, looking back on it, you'd open the front door, and you look like... Yeah.
Family of five. The kitchen was a closet.
Well, they had a really sad situation. They had a son who died.
Really?
Yeah, when he was young, like five, maybe four or five, and there were pictures of him with like a little straw hat and like he worked at Shakey's or something. And now, what had happened was Bob Ringwald, the dad, was blind, and he liked himself that Dixieland music. I've always told you. Here's how you know why you have to really get specific with people, because one time I was talking to Bob Ringwald, and he said, "You know what I love? I love two things." I said, "Yeah." He said, "I love jazz and I love comedy." And I said, "I love jazz and I love comedy too, Bob." And he said, "That's right, Dixieland and Gallagher." And I thought, wow. That's why we need to be specific in life. You know what I mean? Because 10 seconds ago, we were getting married.
Yeah, you were simpatico.
And then next thing you know, I was beating his blind ass with a snow shovel. So he loved himself some Dixieland. And he wanted, you know, he had this young son. And I saw pictures of him around the house wearing the little outfit, you know, and doing the three-part harmony and all that, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I don't know, he died, you know, he wasn't run over by a train or something. He had some sort of childhood disease or whatever. But he died, and then Molly was going to be the singer. And she did albums with the group. You know, he had like a...
Yeah, she's an amazing singer.
She's a great singer.
Yeah, she was in cabaret.
She was singing when she was 3 years old and 5 years old, and she was singing with Bob's Dixieland band. And they came out here from Placerville, which is up north.
Sacramento.
Sacramento, Northern California. And they came out here, I think they came out here for her sister Beth's acting career. And Molly like sort of tagged along. And next thing you know, she was in Annie. And
Tempest really is the one that ejected her, too.
The Tempest. But Annie was at the whatever theater. And she was one of the chicks from Annie. She wasn't Annie, but she was one of the orphans. And so, but anyway, Adele Ringwald was the mom, and she was, and probably still is, a sort of dour person, not a mean person, but sort of sad.
Do you think she was like that before her little boy died, or maybe
you know?
Later?
It's so weird, like when you're 15 or 16 and you're just walking in and you smell pie and that's what you're thinking of. When are we going to get some pie? And you see this woman and she looks sort of distant and looks sort of sad, and then you think, you're never really putting together the picture of the five-year-old son that's gone, you know, that maybe she's still obviously still thinking about. They had another son, Kelly, who was just a nice guy, but he's just a regular guy. wasn't into any of the showbiz stuff or anything like that. It's really weird how different siblings can be. I think he's doing computer stuff now.
Yes, he's a computer expert.
So I used to go over there, but Adele, in this house that was the size of your fist, just baked. She loved to bake.
Like a bakery. Like, she was baking dozens and dozens of whatever.
And all I did was play football, lift weights, and eat. And I was crazed. I told you a million times. I really can't put a fine enough point on this. I was a crazed raccoon, and the world was my dumpster. I was like a grizzly bear on a campsite, just tearing in. What is this? Give me some of that. give me that. So I would just go over there and go nuts. And she loved it because her kids didn't really seem to give a shit that much. Just
right,
as it always seems, it always works that way. They're like,
there's
ah, so mom's made
whatever, yeah, yeah. a pie.
Mom's made another pie. Big
yeah.
whoop.
Yeah.
And I'd never seen my mom make anything that came out of an oven. I think the only thing I saw come out of an oven was her head. She was trying to kill herself one time.
She had a Sylvia Plath moment.
She yelled freak out after a bad session in an encounter group. And that was the only thing I saw ever come out of
it. The only thing she cooked up was reasons to stay in her room.
That's right.
Not go to your football game.
That's right. And my dad didn't fucking even know what an oven. I don't think my dad knew what an oven was. So he probably like get into it and try to drive it. So I couldn't believe that there was this
Where's
fresh...
Where's the ignition on this thing?
Yeah, it's not turning over. I couldn't believe... And, you know, I'd had a couple, like, Stouffer's frozen pastries or something, but I couldn't believe
this handmade...
I mean, right. She was one of those things, like, rolling it out with that thing that put the dimples in it and all... I mean, making... She would do that thing where she'd make the apple pie and take the strands of
the crisscross,
make the basket weave over the top. And I'd just go over there and go fucking apeshit.
Yeah, but Teresa, there were two things. I mean, he was in love with Beth, and her mom cooked like a maniac, too.
Yeah.
The Ringwald household was a paradise for you.
Yeah, it really was.
Well, it had an open door policy, too. I mean, kids used to kind of just go in and out of
the
house.
Yeah, I'd just blow in there and Adele liked me.
Yeah.
And I love that Adele liked that you wanted to eat her pies.
Yes.
Appreciated.
I want to eat her daughter's pie, too.
I want to eat her pie.
Now, yes.
You had to choose.
Yeah, but isn't Bob also the hardest working blind man? I mean, that guy.
What was Bob doing for a living?
He constantly works.
Bob worked. I mean, Bob Ringwald was blind and he would work. And Bob.
Every day.
Got his ass around town.
Nothing stopped this guy.
And at a certain point, they would go down. They opened a little restaurant, shop, cafe, or whatever down at the Van Nuys Courthouse. And he would walk himself down Laurel Canyon with the stick, you know, walk down to Chandler, you know, two, three big blocks away, sit on the bus stop, catch the bus, get on the bus, take it down to Van Nuys. I don't think I could take a bus to Van Nuys. My sight is fine. Get on the bus, take it to Van Nuys, go into the courthouse, blind like somebody put a pillowcase over your head, and just go to work.
Incredibly self-reliant.
Totally self-reliant.
Well, this is a story that is continuing to creep people out. I don't know if you heard about the Pennsylvania gunman who went into the gym.
Yes.
He targeted the Latin Impact dance class.
Sure.
He shot three women. Then he shot himself, 48-year-old George Sedini. Now, there are a lot of blogs.
Well, he wounded his girlfriend, his estranged girlfriend.
Well, initial reports said that he knew one of the women.
Oh, now he didn't?
And now they're saying that they were strangers.
Oh, good.
So that's the latest on him.
Thank Christ, because I thought it was one of those things where he went in, shot everyone, and sort of wounded his girlfriend, which is a ton for her to live with, obviously.
Right.
But it's also mission officially unaccomplished, Jackoff. But he just went in and shot the Latin dance class?
He shot up the Latin dance class, and then he shot himself. He killed three women, 46, 49, and 39 years old, according to the Allegheny Coroner's Office.
Why can't people just fucking kill
themselves?
Just shoot yourself.
Well, here are some of... he kept some online diaries. He also kept some video blogs, which are posted online. And he wrote about his life and some of his frustrations. He apparently had not had sex since 1990.
Mm.
And he detailed some of his plans for the attack in these blogs. Here are some things he wrote in November of 2008. He said, planned to do this in the summer, but figured to stick around to see the election outcome. This particular one got so much attention, and I was just curious. Not like I give a flying who won, since this exit plan was already planned. Good luck to Obama. The liberal media loves him. America, with a K, has chosen the black man. Good. In light of this, So he goes on about that for a while. Okay, then he starts talking about his Christmas. This is in 2000. This is December.
You know, I got to jump in and say, I hate it when guys give us racists a bad name. I really do. It's guys like this that ruin it.
Not all racists are homicidal.
Family-oriented, hard-working, pie-eating racists.
Now,
and these guys got to go fucking smear mud all over our good name. Yes.
That doesn't seem right.
You know what must have been surreal, too? So you know what those Latin jazz, whatever, they're pumping the music, right?
Yeah. And Mark Anthony.
First thing I would have done was shot the stereo if Mark Anthony was playing. But the point is I need to know. But the point is this guy went in and did his fucking crazy massacre thing. People were screaming and smoke in the air and whatever. Then he shoots himself. And you know, for a good 5 minutes, everyone was lying on the ground with some crazy Latin rhythm thing pounding.
Right. No one turns it down out of
respect. There was some like Los Lobos remix thing just blaring, adding a crazy, surreal feeling to everyone lying on the ground, screaming blood, whatever, smoke. And I was just lying there, and that music just had to just continue to pump for another 5 minutes.
Death and Destruction, and then you can hear J-Lo's Let's Get Loud.
Right.
Disco remix.
Now, why did he shoot up that class?
He had his eye on that class. He wrote about the women at the gym. Here's what one thing he wrote.
No.
Many of the young girls here look so beautiful as to not be human. Very edible.
Can I say this? I say it every time. I know it's bizarre. Like, we're all shocked. Like, hey, man, wow. Look what happened in Pennsylvania. But considering the amount of guns that are in circulation.
Right.
And it's staggering. It's something like, well, there's 300 million Americans and 300 million and one guns, like, in circulation. The amount of guns, the amount of booze.
Right.
The amount of people that consume said booze. You know, the liquor stores on every corner, you know, filled with tequila, you know. The prescription drugs, and then not only prescription, then there's meth and there's coke and there's all the other drugs, heroin and all that kind of stuff. All the guns, all the booze, all the illegal and not illegal drugs, over-the-counter prescription drugs, and then all the mental illness that goes unchecked in this society.
Let me add, no background check if you buy your gun at a gun show.
And none of that. All that, and twice a year, somebody wigs out somewhere.
It should be more.
It should be more. I mean, I don't want it to be more, but it should be more.
Well, in his case, though, what if prostitution was legal and he was getting laid?
Well, he had not been. Donnie makes a good point. He had not had sex. He writes in one of his blogs, no girlfriend since 1984. Last Christmas with Pam was in 1983. No sex since July 1990 either. I was 29. He then goes on and
by the way, Pam is what he used to beat off with.
He sprayed it?
He was out of Jergens.
He sprayed?
Yeah.
Nonstick?
I've done that too. Like, well, Pam ran out on me. So I'm just going to spend New Year's alone.
Or either that or with I Can't Believe It's Not Betty. Okay, he then wrote, no gym today. My elbow is sore again. I actually look good. I dress good. Am clean shaven. Bathe. Touch of cologne. Yet 30 million women rejected me over an 18 to 25 year period. That is how I see it. 30 million is my rough guesstimate of how many desirable single women there are. A man needs a woman for confidence.
But he didn't approach every single one of those 30 million.
Yeah, so he can't count them.
Well, that's in his mind.
Look, obviously the guy's nuts. And, you know, thank God he killed himself so we wouldn't have to just pay for this guy's room and board in some prison for the next 50 years. But please, people, kill yourself first and then go to the fucking gym and start the massacre.
You've said this many times.
You're going to kill yourself. Just kill yourself.
In one of his video postings, he includes a picture of a cat named Snippers, whom he describes as the best cat ever. Snippers, according to the site, lived from 1984 to 1999.
Well, you know he's insane because my cat Norman was the best cat ever.
Obviously.
So obviously the man
How
is deranged.
How did he not know this?
Well, gunning down the people at the health club, you know, that's an indicator you may be nuts, but saying Snippers better than Norman, that's I'm Napoleon. I need to be chased with a butterfly net nuts. Oh, good.
Well,
may rest in hell.
It's summer in Florida.
Mm-hmm.
And that means some crazy shit's going to go on over there. Crazier than usual.
Mm-hmm.
In a setback to her nascent U.S. Senate campaign, porn star Stormy Daniels, real name Stephanie Clifford, was arrested Saturday afternoon for domestic violence after she allegedly battered her husband because she was, quote, upset because the way the laundry had been done. You think she'd been listening to Springsteen songs?
Hey! This one's going out to all the bitches who don't know the difference between the colors and the whites! Now listen!
That's a Pittsburgh guy.
It don't take snuggles to fabric soften and bad. I understand you got to separate your loads, ladies. And your man wants to come home into some nice, clean, fresh dungarees, still warm from the dryer. 2, 3, 4!
Now, she was...
Oh, if I could just get to Bruce.
She was nabbed for striking her husband. He did not do the laundry correctly.
I like to think of a maid and a nanny as a crutch. I'd never let one of my ladies use one of these maids, especially twice a week. 2, 3, 4!
A lot of stuff rhymes with crutch. You should write the lyrics and then just get it to them. She told cops she did not intentionally hit her husband for not doing the laundry correctly, but acknowledged tossing a potted plant in the kitchen sink, throwing the couple's wedding album on the floor, breaking some candles. The adult film actress was briefly booked, where she was later released.
Breaking candles. First off, candles are almost impossible to break cleanly because of the wick.
Yeah.
You know? And if you do it with a sword, you're the coolest guy on the planet. You know, with the candelabra, whoosh! You know what I mean? Hey, you know what used to be a cool move? When I grew up, I used to watch those movies, and where the guy do the thing where he'd do, like, he'd get the sword out, and he'd do the whoosh, and he'd either hit the candles, or he'd hit somebody, or whatever, and you'd go, well, I see you missed. And then a second later, they would all fall over. That was a cool move. She's breaking candles?
She broke a candle, potted plant.
Every time you break a candle, a rabbi cries.
Do you know that? Yeah, I've heard that.
She broke a candle.
She broke a candle.
What kind of asshole would call the cops on his wife with the domestic stuff? I would never do that.
A husband that does the laundry.
Yeah. 2, 3!
By the way, a brief note, since this woman is an adult star, I finally got This Ain't Gilligan's Island.
This ain't
Gilligan's Island, the porn version.
Yeah, they had this ain't, the Brady Bunch was like on the Playboy Channel or something the other night. All these porns, I didn't even watch it. Must have beat off already. I don't know why I didn't watch it. But
ain't Gilligan's Island, and I can only review the first 12 minutes.
These are porn movies that are knockoffs of these shows, and they must... legally have to just say this isn't
right,
and then do it. This isn't Happy Days.
Right, there's not the Brady Bunch.
Right.
I saw that. And then This Ain't Gilligan's Island, but This Ain't Gilligan's Island has a brilliant twist. It's postmodern. Because what happens is a regular porn crew is shooting a porn on an island. And mm-hmm. this is contemporary looking porn stars. The girl's tatted up. She's mm-hmm. kind of, you know, and the guy looks like your standard porn star. And they're shooting, and all of a sudden, they see Gilligan. Mm-hmm. And he and all the rest of the crew, the millionaire, Ginger, everyone, they're marooned on the island. Mm-hmm. And this porn crew stumbles across this group of castaways. Mm-hmm. And they realize that they're sex starved, and also that Gilligan is hung, because they see him peeing in the woods.
Sure.
And so they decide to do like a hidden camera thing, where they, the porn stars, have sex with the castaways. Mm-hmm. And I got to say, Marianne, she's one of the best porn stars. I don't know who she is, but she's perfect. She looks really innocent. She doesn't have tattoos or anything. It was stellar.
I got to tell you.
I have to call my girlfriend Pam.
Mrs. Weez doesn't watch porn at all. But, you know, of course, she listens to the podcast, and she heard about This Ain't the Brady Bunch. And she's been bothering me now to, like, go get her This Ain't the Brady Bunch.
Oh, really?
So good.
It's the weirdest thing in the world. Because, like, she thinks porn is, like, kind of weird and disgusting.
I can't buy porn because of my recognition level. But if you want to send Jay down to the Odyssey on a little run, no problem.
I highly recommend not the Brady Bunch because of the laugh track.
All right.
Okay, also in Florida. What's going on with the exotic pets? It seems like people in Florida are way more likely to have pets they shouldn't.
I'll tell you who likes exotic pets. Stupid white people. Dumbass white people. They love snakes.
They do.
Guys, there's not a Jew on the planet that has a boa constrictor. But whitey, love all same mullety, hillbilly, they love snakes. So They're into snakes. They're into like gators. They're into piranhas and pythons. They're into all that. They're in all that shit. And they're always idiots. All the guys that are into reptiles are the actual reptile is smarter than they are.
God, that you may be onto something. In this case, an alligator capture in Tallahassee, Florida, led to the arrest of some North Florida apartment tenants who forgot to hide their drugs. According to a report from the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission, some wildlife officers received a tip that two gators were being held captive in an apartment in Tallahassee. They went to the apartment, they spoke with the tenants, who then said the officers could just go on in and get the gators. But they decided not to hide their drug paraphernalia.
Well, I think when you're really high, you make bad decisions.
Right.
I think that's part of it.
Come on in and get the gators.
Hey, I'll tell you why I would be a horrible cop, because every single thing would, every exchange for me would end up with, just get your shit together. I don't, you know, you'd open the apartment door, you'd have that waft of lard, you know, that the people that cook with lard, you know, smells like bacon fat and BO and gator shit.
It's
like
the opposite
water.
Of the Ringwald house.
Yeah, yeah, where I got the nice waft of pie when I walked in the front door and the super hot Beth Ringwald. But yeah, you know that thing where you're like, I don't want to go in here. I don't want to see you. Like, buddy, fat guy's got a shirt off. You know what I mean? Chick's a mess. She's smoking. You know what I mean? This is why I would be I'd be a horrible cop, because I wouldn't even want to get my hands dirty. I just, everything for me
just,
would
just
be
a warning.
Like,
just a warning.
Everything would be like, look, man.
Just set the gator.
Take the fucking gator and throw it out in the fucking Everglades, would you?
And like, and, I see the bag of meth. If you could just.
You know what? Just fucking put it in the drawer and shut it, would you? And don't beat your old lady, and I won't have to come back. You know, and put on some Old Spice, would you? And everything would end with that. None of it would be like, let's get the zip ties, pull the cruiser along, sir, you know, lady who I don't want to see naked, please get dressed, you know. Like, I would just, everything would end with, you know what, just come on.
Just maintain. That would be come your on. Entire policing philosophy. So,
no, I don't want to go into the bathroom and see the gators in the tub. I don't want to. By the way, I don't want to see your infant who's shit all over himself and diaper needed to be changed a month ago. I don't even come in here.
I don't want to see your toothless relatives.
Right, just do your shit. I'm gonna split. You watch. You finish watching the roast of Larry the Cable Guy. But you know what? If I come back, I'm going to be pissed.
Please don't give me a reason to come back here.
Don't give me a reason to come
back. I don't
want to
come back.
It's a little less. Just please, word to the wise. I'm splitting now. Yeah, that'd be me as a cop.
Okay, now do we have time to talk about one of the... I am haunted by this drunk driving story. I don't know if you heard about this woman in New York. She was leaving a campground. She killed 8 people driving the wrong way on a New York highway.
Yeah.
Now... This woman, she was with 3 of her nieces. She was with 2 of her kids. The only person to survive was her 5-year-old son. She hit an SUV with 3 guys in it. They all died. And according to toxicology reports, she was drunk and high. She had the equivalent of 10 drinks in her, 36-year-old woman. And some of them, they said, hadn't even metabolized. It hadn't been digested. There was just booze.
Shots? And this was the morning time?
Yeah, it was the morning time. She had 10 drinks still in her. She had pot. And there was a broken bottle of vodka at the crash scene.
But, I mean, wasn't this... Does this happen at like 10 in the morning? Or is it like 5 in the afternoon? Because I heard it happened in the morning.
I'd read that it happened around 10 in the morning.
I mean, how many Bloody Marys can you put down before you hop in the van? I mean, how much drinking? I understand the nighttime drunk driving
right.
thing,
sure.
I guess. But how much boozing can you do at that hour in the morning?
Yeah, but she's starting her day, so she wants to get loaded because she knows she's got to deal with the kids and she's got to move forward during the day and she's not going to be able to get another drink.
And then the part where you're when you're hardcore about drinking. And we all know the hardcore drinkers, but they're heavyweights. It's like, all right, I drink, you know, I go camping, I get loaded at 7 in the morning, but I get behind the wheel, but I'm a heavyweight. I mean, it's like those guys that are functional alcoholics. They have 3-4 martinis at lunch and they go back up and they make some, you know, they sit down at their desk and no one knows they're drunk, you know? How do you get on going the wrong direction when you're hardcore? You know what I mean? Like, you're heavyweight. You should be able to handle your shit.
And some woman, the co-owner of the campground she was leaving that day, saw her off and said she didn't seem impaired, said she didn't smell alcohol in the woman's breath. Now, yesterday, her husband, Daniel Shuler, came out and said this woman never was drunk in front of him. He never saw her drunk. He insists there's no way she could have been drinking, although they clearly found that her blood alcohol level was twice the legal limit and a vodka bottle in the car. He says there's no way she was drunk. Absolutely not. And lawyer says she's diabetic.
Well, that argument would be great if this was, you know, 1873 and she crashed her buggy into another buggy on a dirt road, but they have toxicology reports, so you can't do the, I'm sorry, she wasn't drunk. Well, sorry, we have we have technology that suggests otherwise. Also, the whole thing with the spouse thing, God knows what spouses don't know. You know, all the spouses of the serial killer, like, you know, oh, she's married to the Green River Killer for 22 years. Like, I never knew where he was going. And I, you know, sure.
Said he was fishing.
Said he'd go fishing. He'd leave in a van, and then he'd come back for duct tape and, you know, an ether rag. And, like, I never knew.
An axe.
Yeah, and an axe. And he'd be down in the basement. I'd hear noises. Like, never underestimate a spouse's ability not to know what the fuck's going on.
Like, what if your wife was up late at night sewing or, say, knitting a scarf for Bruce Springsteen, and you had no idea that all this time she was a master seamstress? You'd never know.
Baby, I was born to sew. No.
Well, I mean, there doesn't seem to be any other option than that he really didn't know his wife, unless they completely screwed up this autopsy.
I guess he's in massive denial. And I mean,
he's just lost his daughter and his
wife. He lost his nieces. He lost his wife. And then of course he killed three guys. I mean, his wife killed three guys. Now you're left with the 5-year-old. I mean, but again, with the amount of booze that's out there and the amount of automobiles that are out there and the amount of confusing road signs that are out there, why doesn't this happen more often? Maybe it happens like Nicole Richie, and there's just bullets dodged. Like, Nicole Richie could have ended up this way, but she didn't hit anybody, and so we just kind of moved on.
Well, he gave a news conference, Daniel Shuler, and he said, "My heart is at rest. Every night I go to bed, she did not drink." So maybe they'll exhume the body and do another autopsy, but, I mean, there was a vodka bottle in the car.
Listen, sometimes, it's in Florida and the car overheats and you pull over and you gotta, you know, some people use water, other people use pop off. I don't know. Like, I feel horrible for the guy. I also hate the guys who are just in crazy denial. Like, I didn't do that. Wasn't me. Like, wasn't her. Didn't get done. Like, listen, bullshit. There's fucking vodka bottle in the car. Just start saying you're sorry, would you please? I mean, I don't know what he said during the thing, but when you say my wife wasn't drunk, you're not saying sorry.
He said she was the perfect wife, an outstanding mother, hard worker, reliable person, trustworthy. I'd marry her again tomorrow.
Oh, the day our marriage vows. You know, most people, they pull the veil aside and kiss your bride. He pulled the lampshade off of her head and he kissed the bride. Just fucking say you're sorry. Say you have no idea your wife was an alcoholic, and do the thing where you go, I'm sorry to all the people and the families of the people who lost loved ones because of this tragic incident.
Yeah.
Don't do the, she was great, she wasn't an alcoholic, because that nullifies all the damage she did.
Yeah, their meanwhile, loss. Guy Bastardi, 49, dead. Michael Bastardi, 81, dead. Daniel Longo, 74, also died in that SUV.
Women that are abused in a relationship, you know, the man that beats the hell out of them, don't they always say that the man is a great man? They're in denial also. Isn't this role reversal once again with male and female?
Well, they
he's in denial, right?
Yeah, he's in denial, obviously. A bottle of vodka in the minivan, for the love of Christ.
And as you said, he's probably in horrible shock and grief and doesn't know what he's saying.
Right.
And I don't know how you'd make sense of something like that. I do know how you would make sense of John Mayer, and that is by looking at his tweets. So I will leave you with this, because, you know, often we take a look at John Mayer and we try to understand, is he a douchebag?
Can't figure it out.
And we can't figure it out. Now, last thing, I think we discussed his appearance at the Michael Jackson funeral.
Right.
And that put him clearly in the non-douchebag camp, because you liked his work.
Played Human Nature on the guitar.
Sounded good. Seemed okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he's really, really into Twitter.
Hugged a bunch of guys with weird gloves on. Whose fucking idea that was? But all right.
So he had, I looked up some of his most recent tweets, mm-hmm. even though yesterday there was a problem with Twitter. He's really into Twitter, and he has like 1.8 million followers or more.
Mm-hmm.
Tons.
Mm-hmm.
So here are some of
his
tweets.
He's only fucked 1.2 of them, to be fair.
There are plenty of them
yet unfucked.
He hasn't
fucked all of them. That's right.
Right.
There's 600,000 he hasn't gotten to yet.
So here are some of his recent missives.
It'd be funny if he hung out with the guy who hadn't gotten laid since 1990.
They would cancel each other out.
When did you get laid last? 19 years ago? How about you? What day is it? 10 seconds
Hold
ago?
On. Wait, I'm finishing.
Hold on, I got to finish. let me just finish on Jessica Simpson. Okay. What were right you then. Saying? What were you saying, weirdo?
Go ahead, freaky guy. What was your cat's name? Snippy?
Snippy? Hold
Tell
on.
Me more.
Hold on, I got a blowjob. Hold on. It was someone from Friends to give me a blowjob. I don't remember which one.
I can't remember which one.
Yeah.
The one with the haircut, maybe? I don't know.
I don't want to make the Joey mistake again.
That was... He's pretty from a distance.
Yeah. Anyway. So, sorry. I'm plowing through some starlets. What were you saying? You think about shooting up a gym?
No women have ever loved me, and I'm very angry.
Hold on. I got an orgasm again.
No, but I haven't had the touch of a woman since 1990.
Hold on. Let me play a little blues guitar.
If you could just talk to me for a second.
Yeah. All right. Hold on. I got banged out of starlet.
We have a lot of rage.
Hold on. Something with your cat?
I had the best cat ever, and it died, and I'm so angry, and all 30 million women have rejected me.
Okay, hold on. I got to figure out which one of the Olsen twins I'm going to bang. Or maybe I'll do both of them. Anyway, I got to go look good. I got to do something. What's up? Yeah, those two. I just wish those two could have sat together on a long flight before.
I think they could have learned a lot from each other.
Yes.
Here are some things on John Mayer's mind.
Mm-hmm.
What do you use your empty Altoids tin for? Mm-hmm. I use mine to keep Tic Tacs in.
Mm.
All right. Okay.
Interesting.
I'm in that crucial hour of either being able to leave work and meet up with friends or having to miss it. 10 to 11 p.m., you saucy slag.
All right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Just sent my assistant out for a white tiger. So strange that nobody told me no. It must be because it's a great idea.
I think he's in love with himself. I think that's the problem.
People need to stop using the word actually when reviewing things. Example, 17 again was an enjoyable, funny movie. Okay.
Was that ironic?
I think he was being ironic.
Uh-huh.
And this one, I think maybe... those are all fine. I think this one could be a little douchebaggy. I know it sounds pretentious, but I'm in day two of little to no sleep thanks to the new tune swimming around in my head.
Oh, like he's coming up with new tunes?
Yeah, he's got so much music inside of him.
I just want him to pack on 80 pounds. That's all. That's my only wish.
Well, he's having too much fun.
Sooner or later.
All right, I'm still going... Yeah, he's too busy screwing to really put on any weight. All right, I'm still going blowhard, but I like this work at the Jackson concert. All right, what everyone think of our little experiment? A little day and date news for you with Teresa Strasser. If you like it, we'll keep it going. Maybe we'll try it every Friday. And eventually... take this podcast and sort of turn it into a radio show. Now, the difference between a podcast right now and a radio show is we're sort of, well, you get to us when you get to us. You put your gardening clogs on and you listen to us on the weekend. But the radio show, that's something you listen to every morning. Do you guys want us to go that direction? This was a little day and date experiment to see how you dug it. So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for my news partner, Teresa Strasser, and my good buddy The Wheeze saying... mahalo.
Follow Adam Carolla on Twitter at Adam Carolla. Reach him via Skype at Adam Podcast or through the mail at Adam Carolla Podcast, 10061 Riverside Drive, number 276, Toluca Lake, California, 91602.